Welcome to the Financial Quarterback with your host, Jim Lineweaver.
I'm Jim Lineweaver, your financial quarterback since 1993. You know, you can purchase almost any asset for either income or growth. It just depends on your financial goals. But in retirement, choosing the wrong one can dramatically increase your level of risk and derail an otherwise comfortable retirement. There are also some places that are better to hold these assets than others, especially considering the tax consequences. So as part of the Lineweaver team today, we have Travis and Mark with us, and they're going to help us get through some of these strategies. So Travis, how about individual stocks?
Sure. So stocks can have growth or income characteristics. Growth strategies tend to focus on investing in companies that are experiencing high revenue or high earnings growth and seek to primarily produce returns in the form of price appreciation. Now, on the other hand, dividend strategies tend to focus on investing in more established companies that produce reliable earnings, pay out regular income in the form of dividends.
But we also have to consider not only where we hold them, but also the tax consequences.
That's right, Jim. And the key really is how long you hold these investments. So if you hold them for a year or longer, you get much favorable tax treatment with the long-term capital gains taxes. And that also applies to any qualified dividends versus ordinary income dividends.
And real estate's another asset class that can be used for either growth or income. So Travis, can you give us some background on real estate investment strategies?
Sure. So direct real estate investments, such as an actual rental property, can produce monthly rental income, but can potentially also increase in value over time. Now, if you don't want to be an actual landlord, real estate investment trusts invest directly in income-producing real estate, such as an office property or rental properties, and most of those are exchange-traded just like a regular stock.
And it's important to keep in mind if you're an active or a passive participant, because that really runs into the IRS laws to allow you to deduct those losses. And depreciation is a great tool to offset current income, but it can come back to bite you when you sell the property because you may have to recapture that depreciation as ordinary income.
And what about bonds?
Well, bonds are generally income-focused investments rather than growth or price appreciation. But for investors who are focused on producing current income or focused on capital preservation, it may make sense for those individuals to have a higher allocation to bonds.
And Mark, how about the tax treatment of bonds?
Depending on the type of bond, you could pay federal tax only. You could have triple tax-free bonds like municipals if you're residing in that state, or some of them can even be exempt if you're using them for qualified higher education expenses as well.
That's some great information, guys. So as you can see, it's not just what you hold, but where you hold it, whether it be your IRA, 401k, brokerage account, or somewhere else. And it's also how it's taxed. So that's why at Lineweaver Wealth Advisors, we stress a team approach. We're always here to help, so give us a call. Stay tuned for Chris Wallace coming up next.